3 days later, which we'll be celebrating on this upcoming Sunday. But tonight we're going to be focusing on what Jesus accomplished at Calvary. And it's a joy that we get to be able to do that together as a church family tonight. After our message, we will be partaking of the Lord's table with one another. We will consider and look back upon what Jesus considered, what he accomplished on the cross, even through the practice of communion and partaking of the cup and the wafer. And so we'll have the opportunity to do that as well with one another after our message tonight. But I'm going to go ahead and open us up in a word of prayer this evening, and then we will transition to praising the Lord through song and considering the cross. Let's go ahead and go to him now in a word of prayer. Oh, Father, what a privilege it is that we have to be together tonight as a church family, to look back and consider what happened nearly 2,000 years ago when your Son, our Lord, laid down his life as a ransom for many, that we might have life forevermore. And for Father, we know that it was out of your great and super abundant love that you sent forth your Son to that end. And for that, we rejoice now and forevermore. Lord, as we gather together tonight, Lord, I pray that you would allow us the concentration needed to consider what happened at Calvary. Lord, that we would be reminded of your holiness, of our sinfulness, and the grace and the mercy displayed through what your Son has accomplished. Father, I pray that you would grow us in our love for you, our affection for you, and that we would have a greater reverence for you in considering all that you've accomplished for us. Father, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's rise. Our first hymn is going to be 305, Lead Me to Calvary.
To Calvary.
Verse 2. 296. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
Well, thank you to our praise team for leading us in song. Blessing, certainly, to sing those songs with one another about our great God and to consider what Jesus has accomplished for us. And a big thank you to our praise team for leading us in that way. If you have a Bible, I invite you to join me in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5 is where we'll be tonight in our study, and it'll be a little bit till we get there, but I promise we will make our way there. Have you ever wondered when Good Friday started to be called good? And if you've ever wondered that before, you're not alone, because earlier this week, I was wondering the same thing. Why is Good Friday called good? And I didn't know when that practice started in calling Good Friday good. And so I was interested in this question. I was thinking about this question, started looking into it. And then just later in the same day, someone in the church asked me the same question. And then someone in my family communicated the same. And so if you have that question, if you've wondered that before, then know that you are not alone. Good Friday. There are so many adjectives to choose from. So how did we end up with good? Good Friday, the phraseology. Because it theoretically could have been called Tragic Friday, Suffering Friday. Could have been called Dark Friday. But it isn't any of those. There was just a couple of days ago, the girls were, Hannah and Elizabeth, they were watching a little program, and I think that it was referred to as the Long Sad Friday. But that's not what it's called. That's not what we think of, or that's not the phrase that we think of, the noun Good Friday, when we think of that. And so when did Good Friday become Good Friday, and why? Because when we think of Good Friday, we think of the agonies of the cross, which were twofold. We dwell upon the ferocity and bloodlust of fallen men who hated the light, and lest their deeds be exposed by the light of John chapter 1 and John 3, 19 and following. They sought to murder the very one who came to save that which was his own, John 1, 11. And so when we think of Good Friday, we're thinking of the religious elite. We consider their lies, their blatant false testimonies, their manipulation, and then the torture that subsequently followed under the hands of the Romans, but orchestrated through the religious elite. So that's one side of the equation, but then there's the other side, that which we cannot even begin to comprehend or fathom. It's in Isaiah 53:10 that we read, "But Yahweh was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief." It pleased the Father, God the Father, to crush God the Son. Now, why would he do that? Well, the reason's in verse 5. He was crushed for our iniquities. That's why the Father crushed the Son. Our sin. Jesus said to Peter in John 18:10, "The cup which the Father has given me, shall I not drink it?" Jesus came to drink the cup of Yahweh, the crushing cup of wrath, bearing in his body the impartial judgment for all sins, for all time, for all who had come to him by faith. And the effect of this twofold sufferings of the Savior, it's seen and it's captured by Isaiah in Isaiah 52:14, when he writes, "Just as many were appalled at you, my people, so his appearance was marred more than any man, in his form more than the sons of men." Jesus's appearance and his suffering made him unrecognizable. In Jesus' death, we see the cost of sin. Sin isn't some small inconvenience. Sin isn't just a whoopsie that can simply be forgotten. It costs the life of God's beloved, only begotten Son. And it wasn't a peaceful death. It wasn't just walking down the primrose path. He suffered beyond what even the most tortured martyr in church history could ever begin to fathom. When we think of Good Friday, we think of the scourging. We think of the thorns, the nails, the blood, the cross, and rightfully so. So when, again, did Good Friday become known as good? Well, since the term Good Friday isn't used in Scripture, in order to figure this out, we have to go on a journey through history to figure out and try and discover where this started being used. And in looking into it, like, I expected that right away I'd have the answer and, you know, I'd walk away understanding exactly how things transpired. And I don't have that kind of a grip on things. There wasn't nearly as much as I thought that I'd find on this subject. Doesn't mean there's nothing, but there just wasn't as much as I thought. And the way we're going to approach our study tonight, which will lead us to Romans chapter 5, is first we're going to look at the establishment of the practice of Good Friday, this opportunity to come together to remember and dwell upon what the Savior has accomplished for us. So we'll look at the establishment of the practice. And secondly, we're going to consider the name. Once we understand sort of an idea of how things came to be, to what we know of today and what we celebrate today when we gather together, once we have that as our basis and our foundation, then we'll consider the name itself, where that developed, how it developed, what that process may have looked like. And then finally, we'll conclude our time by considering the reason that we celebrate Good Friday, the why of the matter. So we'll start again with the establishment. So according to the Encyclopedia Britannica, and this is the 11th edition that was published all the way back in 1910, so over a century ago, we read this: prior to the 4th century, there's no evidence of non-celebration of the Eucharist. So that's sort of an odd way, the double negatives. It was common practice. It was known of. There's no evidence that people weren't doing this before the 4th century. And so no evidence of non-celebration of the Eucharist on Good Friday. But after that date, the prohibition of communion became common. In Spain, indeed, it became customary to close the churches altogether as a site of mourning. But this practice was condemned by the Council of Toledo in 1633, I believe. And just so no one gets sidetracked there with Eucharist, that word simply means thanksgiving. That was a word that was regularly used by the early church in speaking of celebrating the Lord's table. That's not an endorsement of the Roman Catholic practice of transubstantiation. They're not one and the same with how the word was originally used. But the reason I share that quote with you, what I think is helpful about that quote, is that we see that there was a time of remembrance that was established and expected, that was normal, that stems all the way back, as we say, prior to the 4th century. So we're looking in the 3rd century, which would be the 200s AD. So we have record looking back all the way back to the 200s that the Lord's table, that communion, was being regularly practiced by local churches. Looking back upon what Jesus accomplished on Good Friday. And so this was a practice, this was expected, this was understood, this was something that the churches did. They would gather together on Good Friday and they would reflect upon what Jesus had done, and that would be capped off, if you will, by partaking of the Lord's table, the body, or cup and the wafer with one another, which represent the body and the blood. There's an individual named T.P. Gilmartin in the Catholic Encyclopedia that references how both Irenaeus and Tertullian speak of Good Friday with reference to a feast. And the feast is interpreted by some as a fast, but you can understand the celebration of communion on such a day. And so just based on those two resources, which I know that's not extensive, but I think we can see and we could gather that it's possible, someone could argue, that it was a normal practice of the early church to celebrate Good Friday, to come together on Good Friday. In the Encyclopedia Britannica, the same 11th edition, there's a connection that's made between the church gathering on Good Friday with the practice of the Passover. And now the emphasis used in that encyclopedia is primarily on those who are ethnically Jewish, really continuing this practice of remembrance, the Passover and then coming together on Good Friday being the connection there, with more of a question mark with the Gentile congregations as to how things began, because they weren't regularly celebrating the Passover. But I think what's helpful to remember here is that all churches began that way. Like, the church that was born at Pentecost was ethnically Jewish, with the exception of the nations mentioned in Acts chapter 2, as well as other Jewish, you know, those who were already Jewish proselytes. And I don't think it's difficult at all to understand the concept of Jewish people continuing a practice of remembrance on this day. After all, in John 19:14, we read, "Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. And he said to the Jews," Pilate did, "behold your king." Jesus was crucified on what day? The Passover. Jesus is crucified on the day the Passover is prepared and celebrated. And that's the connection. It's right there. Such that Paul would go on in writing to a primarily ethnically Gentile church in Corinth. And in 1 Corinthians 5:7-8, he'd say, "Clean out the old leaven so that you may be a new lump, just as you are in fact unleavened, for Christ our Passover. For Christ our Passover lamb also was sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." Celebrating the feast, remembering Christ. Christ is the Passover lamb. But he isn't just the Passover lamb for the Jewish people, for those who are ethnically Jewish, those who are accustomed to celebrating the Passover. No, he is the Passover for all who place their faith in him, regardless of ethnic background, social status, job title, educational accolades, or any of that. It's actually all the way back in Exodus chapter 12 that we're first introduced to the Passover, though it's was foreshadowed back in the garden in Genesis chapter 3 after Adam and Eve had sinned, and then God sacrifices an animal to cover Adam and Eve. But the Passover is associated with the final plague that would be poured out on the land of Egypt. And if you're familiar with the account, then you know that it was the most severe plague of them all. The death of the firstborn sons of all the families in the land that did not celebrate the Passover. So Moses and Aaron, they commanded the Israelites who were in Egypt to take a year-old lamb. And in Exodus 12, verses 6 through 13, it says this, "And you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. Moreover, they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. And they shall eat the flesh that night, roasted with fire, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled at all with water, but rather roasted with fire, both its head and its legs, along with its entrails. And you shall not leave any of it over until morning, but whatever's left of it until morning you shall burn with fire. Now you shall eat it in this manner, with your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat it in haste. It is the Passover of Yahweh." Verse 12, "And I will go through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am Yahweh. And the blood shall be a sign for you on your houses where you are, and I will see the blood and I will pass over you, and there shall be no plague among you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." Just in case there's anyone here and not as familiar maybe with the Exodus account, and who's thinking, "Wow, that seems very harsh and that's very strong," I would encourage you to read the account. The Egyptians majored in sinning against God, majored in rebelling against God. In fact, it was God's patience on display that they weren't, this judgment didn't come much earlier. And so the lamb would be slain in the place of the people. It's what we see. Moses and Aaron command Israel to do that based on the word of the Lord. And when the people would do that, when they would cover their homes in the blood, God's wrath would pass over their homes as they listened to his word. And that's exactly what happens in verses 29 to 30. Now, it happened at midnight that Yahweh struck all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne, so the heir, to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. Then Pharaoh arose in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was no home where there was not someone dead. So we see judgment take place in exact accordance with the word of the Lord. But what I don't want you to miss is the houses that were covered by the blood, they were passed over. Everyone was safe. Everyone was saved. Everyone was delivered. And of course, understanding that background allows John the Baptist's words to burst with significance. In John 1:29, on the next day, he saw Jesus coming to him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Jesus is the Lamb of God. He is the Lamb that all the other lambs foreshadowed and looked toward. The Lamb who actually takes away sin, the blessed ramification of which all who take refuge in him, trusting in God's provision, even as Israel did in the past, wrath and punishment will pass over that individual. Christ is our Passover. So I don't think it is at all difficult to see how the early church would continue to celebrate on the day of the Passover. Not looking back to the day that God delivered his people physically from Egypt, as great and as marvelous as that event was, but instead looking back to the day when God delivered his people for all time from his righteous wrath through the sufficient sacrifice of his son, Jesus, in our place. And then, of course, that taking place, the early church, the church is born at Pentecost. Again, the church is primarily ethnically Jewish. They're continuing, presumably, to celebrate on the Passover, looking at Christ our Passover, considering what he'd accomplished. And then when they went out and preached the gospel in Jerusalem, or where it began, it was being preached throughout Jerusalem. But then as Acts 1:8 continues, through Judea in Samaria. So we're going from south to north in Israel and even to the end of the earth, the nations. And with that, it's not difficult to see, it's not far-fetched to understand that that practice and celebration would go from Jerusalem to the world. And just to be clear, like abundantly clear, there's no command to celebrate this day in Scripture, but that doesn't mean it's wrong to do so either. I just want you to see that this is something that the church has done possibly since its inception. So the establishment. I think we can be certain that in the 200s, possibly even a little before that, just from church history, that this practice was going on. But I think looking at the text itself, looking at the celebration and the remembrance of this day is something that certainly could have happened since the very nexus and beginning of the church. And so that's the establishment of the practice. It's old. It's been going on for a long time that churches have gathered together to consider and remember what Jesus did on Good Friday. And so that brings us to the name, Good Friday. Good Friday might not even be the original name. In fact, I don't think that it is. And just as a note here on the outset, there are a lot of moving parts in this conversation. There are different languages involved. There are different time periods where names for this time come up. Some argue that the name's originally German. Others argue it's originally Latin. Some even will appeal to English. Gil Martin, who I referenced earlier, spoke about how the Romance languages historically refer to this day as Holy Friday. But he also mentions how some considered it and referred to it, though albeit more of a minority, God's Friday. Some refer to it as the Long Friday. It's not exhaustive. There are some who consider this day to be not what happens in November, but this day to be Black Friday. in considering Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. In present-day German, it's referred to as Morning Friday. So I just want to show you Good Friday, that it's not something that's used necessarily the world over, though it is popular. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, the earliest known use of Good Friday is in the Middle English period, so from about 1150 to 1500. The earliest evidence that the Oxford English Dictionary could find for Good Friday being used in that form was in around the year 1300. So Good Friday, the noun, it could have been used earlier than that, but that's as far back as the record goes at present. You know, if we find more resources, that could be updated over time. The word, though, good itself, it does appear to have originally meant holy. And that's what another Oxford resource references as well. In the time period in which it was used, that was what good meant. It meant holy with how it was being used in this context. And if that is the case, that would certainly give precedent to the Romance languages referring to this day as Holy Friday. And that does seem to me to be the origin based on what I've seen, that Good Friday is Holy Friday, and that being the thrust of what's being communicated. But just in case anyone's sad about that, which I don't think you should be, even if Good Friday really is Holy Friday, it doesn't in any way change what I think about the day, and I don't think that it should for you either. It is a holy day. It is a good day. And while goodness and holiness aren't one and the same, they are inextricably linked in this case. So Good Friday, Holy Friday, we've seen the establishment, we've seen the name, and so that brings us to the reason. That brings us to the why. Why is Good Friday good? And I think we've spoken some about the reason already, admittedly, but we've sort of been circling. We've been hovering. We haven't really gotten into the nitty-gritty. And so that's what we're going to be doing in Romans chapter 5. And so if you haven't flipped there already, we will be in Romans chapter 5 now, just for a little bit with one another tonight. We're going to be considering the reason of why Good Friday is good. And I think this will be profitable for us. Regardless of when Good Friday started to be celebrated as such, Good Friday became Good Friday when Jesus laid down his life exactly as he said he would in John 10, 17, and 18. It was the Friday when the Son of God, for the joy set before him, endured the cross. And Jesus, on the cross, suffered as a substitute, as our representative. And he bore that which we deserve to bear eternally for breaking God's standard, the perfect standard of our triune God. Jesus was forsaken in time so that we won't be forsaken forevermore. And it's because of the death of death and the death of Christ, to use Owen's language, that we have, as Bunyan says, life, life, eternal life. Had Jesus not done what he did, we would be a people utterly and entirely without hope. And to be in a state like that is exactly what we deserved. So in Romans 5, 6 through 8, we read this: "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for the good man, someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So with those verses right there, Paul just explained exactly why Good Friday is good. Good Friday is Good Friday because without Jesus' death on the cross, without God's love shown forth, there is absolutely nothing to look toward, no hope for anyone. And there are no exceptions with that statement. If God didn't show forth his love toward mankind, if he didn't show forth his mercy, his grace, his compassion at Calvary, then our ever-present expectation is judgment and sentencing. That is the expectation for many, for most, on the broad road that leads to destruction. But Paul in Romans is writing to those on the narrow road, the constrained way. He's writing to those who've counted the cost and consider the momentary sufferings of this life and following Christ to be worth, more than worth, the eternal weight of glory to be bestowed upon us in living with Christ forevermore. And it's in verse 6 that we see simply unfathomable news. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. So here we see in verse 6 a statement about the Roman church. It's a statement about you and me. It's a statement about the church of God, about everyone who's been born again, that while we were weak, something unthinkable happened. And the word for weakness, it's used in various ways in the scriptures, is used to speak of illness and sickness. We see that a number of times. To give you an example, in Acts 5, 14 through 15, Luke says, "And more than ever, believers in the Lord were added to their number, multitudes of men and women, to such an extent that they even carried," right here, "the sick out into the streets and laid them on cots and mats so that when Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on any one of them." That's an incredible account right there, just to see the miraculous ministry, the signs, wonders, and miracles that were wrought at the hands of the apostles. But you can see there that this word can be used to speak of physical impairments, sickness, people on cots and mats. The words used by Peter in speaking of the woman as the weaker vessel, so they're speaking of physical strength. Used by Paul to speak of how the false apostles would speak of him in person as being unimpressive and weak, his personal presence not being strong. So there is some breadth there, but none of those are exactly how this word is used in our passage. I do want you to see it, though, because there is some relation. Weakness in our text, as has been given to us by Paul in Romans 5:6, speaks to inability. Inability. And this isn't inability concerning physical matters, where this word is primarily used in other contexts, but instead spiritual ones. Left unto ourselves, we are unable, entirely unable, to be the people that God has called us to be. In case there's any question or speculation about, I'm not sure if Paul's really using this word in that way, maybe it is speaking more of physical weakness, look at Romans 5:8. How does Paul use a similar phrase? "But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners." What is Paul highlighting here? While we were weak, while we were sinners. Those are related. Verse 6, while we were unable. Corresponds with the language of Paul in Ephesians 2:1, "And you were dead." And you were dead in your transgressions and sins. Those that are spiritually dead can't do anything that pleases the Lord while seeking to deny him, either through the pursuit of the world or stiff-arming the cross through seeking to earn their own salvation. We were entirely unable. And it was in our weakness that proved to be the appropriate time for what follows. Galatians 4:4-5, we read, "But when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to what effect? The purpose, so that he might redeem those who are under the law, that we might receive adoption as sons." So when the fullness of time came, here in our passage, it's the right time. It's the appointed time. To slightly adapt Peter's language from Acts chapter 2, verse 23, it's a predetermined time. Everything in this world is on God's timetable. Everything is on his schedule. We're on his schedule. Anytime we start to pretend that we're on our own schedule, what does God do? He lovingly, in discipline, will bring trials along that will remind us that we're not on our own schedule, but we're on his. And that's what a good and gracious Father will do, because we need those reminders. I need those reminders. There's not an event that happens outside of God's time. And it's no exception with what we're speaking of here. There is a reason that Jesus didn't come in the days of Abraham. I'm not talking about the appearances of the pre-incarnate Christ like in Genesis 18. That's not the idea I have in mind. There's a reason he didn't come in the days of Abraham to lay down his life, or in the days of Moses, or in the days of David, or in the days of the major or minor prophets. It had to be at this time when Good Friday occurred, just about 2,000 years ago. It didn't happen a day too early, didn't happen a day too late. It was the time that God had set apart with the backdrop of the scriptures and the prophetic texts, the expectation and wait that one day Messiah would come. One day he would come to save and redeem. One day, as we read about in Isaiah 53, he would come to lay down his life. I doubt there's anyone questioning it, but just a comment on there, just in case there's someone out there who's wondering. Every time the word ungodly is used in verse 6, every time that word ungodly is used in the New Testament, it speaks of someone who doesn't believe in the Lord. Every single time. This isn't someone who's walking in sin committing sin for a day or two or for a week or something like that or a month. As far as I can tell, always without exception, this speaks of someone who is dead in sin. It speaks of someone who is unable to please God. It speaks of someone who is living in the flesh. And this verse, verse 6, is incomprehensible. Were verse 6 not written, we would never believe it. God is holy, holy, holy. His perfection is incalculable. His wisdom is unsearchable, and his righteousness is incomprehensible. And the King Yahweh of hosts, whose eyes, as Habakkuk 1:13 says, are too pure to look upon evil with delight. He looked down and had mercy on such great sinners. Our world does just about everything that it can to suppress the truth that God is holy. Because if God is holy, if God is just, that means there is absolute justice to be meted out. It means it isn't just significant what happens with your hands, but in your heart. It's not just who you are when you're around others, but who you are in private. Who you are before you go to bed, who you are when no one is looking. It means that there is accountability. It means that there is a standard. And that thought terrifies the ungodly. And you know what? It terrified me before I was saved. In Isaiah 6, 3 through 5, we see a rapturous scene. The Lord is high and lifted up. His robe is filling the temple and flowing through it. He's on his throne, and the seraphim cry out, "Holy, holy, holy is Yahweh of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And then in verse 4, "And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called out while the house of God was filling with smoke. Then I said, 'Woe is me, for I am ruined. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I live on among a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, Yahweh of hosts.'" The Lord is holy, and Isaiah's response was fear. Why? Because he understood in an instant his own sinfulness, his own unworthiness. God is perfect. He is without sin. He is light. Perfect light in him, as John says in 1 John 1:5, there is no darkness at all. And yet, what did we just read in Romans 5:6? What did Paul say? Paul says that God's own son, the one who John tells us in John 12:41, is Yahweh of hosts, high and lifted up in Isaiah 6. That God's own son died for the ungodly. That Jesus Christ died for that which rejected and opposed him. When there was nothing we could do when we were unable, ungodly, when we were Jesus' opposite, that's when he died for us. And for the saint, that reality is simply mind-boggling. It's overwhelming to consider that. Even to draw upon David's words in Psalm 23 when he says, my cup overflows. It's what should happen in the soul of a saint. For all the days of eternity, we will revel in and marvel at the wonders of this statement. While we were weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. That is a statement that you never outgrow. It's a statement that you never move past. We cannot begin to grasp the condescension, mercy, and grace and compassion seen there. Jesus Christ, the Lord, died for the ungodly. Let that be something you take to heart this evening. Charles Spurgeon once said this, if Christ died for the ungodly, this fact leaves the ungodly no excuse if they don't come to him and believe in him unto salvation. Had it been otherwise, they may have pleaded, we're not fit to come, but you're ungodly. And Christ died for the ungodly. Why not you? After considering what Christ did in a moment in time, Paul continues in his argument and his logic in expounding upon the sheer compelling nature of what Jesus has done in verse 7. For one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. 1 Samuel 18 through 20, we see an example of this kind of love. 1 Samuel 18, 1 through 4, we read, now it happened when he finished speaking to Saul that the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David. And Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and didn't let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan cut a covenant with David because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was on him and gave it to David with his armor, even his sword and his bow and his belt. I mean, a sword is something that was cherished back then. Probably a number of you who cherish your guns. Think of giving your favorite away. Jonathan loved David. Jonathan demonstrated that. He would, if push came to shove, he would put himself in a spot where he would lay down his life for David if he needed to. And while Jonathan did eventually die in battle, in 1 Samuel 20, we do see Jonathan stick out his neck for David, and he does almost die because his father tries to murder him. Saul tried to murder David more than once in the past. David and Jonathan had a plan to see what was in Saul's heart, and like an exposed nerve, after David missed two meals, Saul's heart showed forth, and it was displayed toward his own son, who he realized had aligned himself with David. In verses 27 through 33 of 1 Samuel 20, we read, now it happened the next day, the second day of the new moon, that David's place was missing. So Saul said to his son Jonathan, why has the son of Jesse not come to the meal, either yesterday or today? Jonathan then answered Saul, David earnestly asked leave of me to go to Bethlehem. And he said, please send me on my way, since our family has a sacrifice in the city. My brothers committed me to attend. So now, if I found favor in your sight, please let me go away that I may see my brothers. For this reason, he's not come to the king's table. Verse 30, then Saul's anger burned against Jonathan. Then he said to him, you son of a perverse, rebellious woman, do I not know that you are choosing the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother's nakedness? For as long as the son of Jesse lives on the earth, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. So now send and bring him to me, for he must surely die. But Jonathan answered Saul, his father, and said to him, why should he be put to death? What has he done? Then Saul hurled a spear at him to strike him down. So Jonathan knew that his father had decided to put David to death. It's fortunate that Saul had such terrible aim. Jonathan spoke up for David. He puts his life on the line. He lived, but he would have been willing to die for David. And there are many other examples that we could give. There are many that could be given from war. Many heroic individuals whose names have been passed down to us who have jumped on grenades to save those around them. Most have lost their lives, but they did it to save others. Even Jesus says in John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. And so Paul in Romans 5:7, he's saying, he's just acknowledging it is so rare that one would lay down his own life for another. Does happen, doesn't happen often. And when it does happen, it happens in one direction. People don't go out of their way to die for those who are evil. They don't go out of their way to sacrifice themselves for the very ones who are against them. So for someone who's righteous, Paul says, a just person, a lawkeeper externally, maybe someone would die for that person. For someone who's good, a lawkeeper externally, seeks to help others, maybe possibly even going beyond righteousness there with how Paul's using it, could just be using it synonymously. But it's possible someone would die for the good man, but not for the person that's wicked. That's the thrust. And that's something we all know to be true. It's low-hanging fruit. Those who were oppressed severely in the 20th century under evil dictators, in Hitler, in Stalin, in Mao, those people under those men who were suffering weren't looking to take a bullet for those guys. It's the last thing they wanted. They wanted those men gone. And that's when we have the whiplash of verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet wicked, while we were yet ungodly, Christ died for us. And with that statement, the heart breaks in awe. How is it possible? How is that statement possible? We were his enemies. Paul says in Romans 5:10, for if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. It is simply unfathomable. It is overwhelming. And it's this consideration that caused Charles Wesley to rejoice in writing, and can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who him to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? Friends, we weren't neutral. We were ungodly. We weren't innocent. We were sinners. We didn't love God. No, in fact, Paul says in unbelief in Romans 1:30, we were haters of God. We stood against God in word, thought, and deed. We were rebels against the one who made us. We are the causes of the cross. We are sinners like Judas who betrayed the one who showed benevolence toward us. We're sinners like Gehazi who preferred that which this world had to offer over the one who made it. We're sinners like Pilate who feared and loved men more than God. We stood condemned and rightfully so. Everything about our condemnation was so right. But Christ Jesus died for sinners. When you think of the cross and you think of what occurred and what Jesus suffered, he went through it for you. He suffered for you. He bled for you. He died for you. And see God's love break forth over the horizon. He didn't die for you when you had your Sunday's best on, when you had your hair all done up right, when you had your shoes polished. He died for you when you were in vile, abject rebellion against him. When Jesus died for you, he died knowing in just under 2,000 years that you'd be born, possibly over depending on when you were born. He knew all the ways that you would sin against him. He knew all the ways that you would deny him. He knew all the times you would serve the God of this world. And knowing all that he knows, he died for you. Friend, be filled with amazement as you consider the cross. Be brought low by the God who loves the undeserving, the unworthy, the dregs of the earth so much that he sent that which is most costly and precious to succumb to the consequence of the fall, that you might be made part of his family and seated at his table forevermore. And for you, if you're here this evening and you remain outside of the cross, for you who think yourself to be too far off, don't for a second believe that God's arm is too short to save. Hear the plea of Spurgeon who says, you will say, oh, but I am one of the worst in the world. Well, Christ died for the worst in the world. Oh, but I have no power to be better. Christ died for those without strength. Oh, but my case condemns itself. Christ died for those who are legally condemned. Aye, but my case is hopeless. Christ died for the hopeless. He is the hope of the hopeless. He's the Savior, not of those who are partly lost, but of the wholly lost. Friends, Christ came to seek and save that which is lost. He came to save sinners just like you. If Jesus is not the master that you follow, come to the cross this evening for salvation. Cry out that you're a sinner in need of a great Savior. Join with the tax collector of Luke 18, who cried out, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. And reap the word that follows in verse 14. I tell you, this man went to his house justified, rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus Christ, as Paul says in 1 Timothy 1:15, came into this world to save sinners. If you are a sinner, you are exactly what is needed to qualify for salvation from the only Savior. Jesus came to save liars, thieves, adulterers, murderers, blasphemers, as many as come to him by faith. Jesus died on the cross for the ungodly. He bore the punishment that we deserve, the judgment due to our sins in his body. And on the third day, he rose from the grave. He is alive today, and all who trust in what Jesus has done, as Paul says in Romans 4:5, all who do not work but believe upon him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. If you trust in Christ, if you rest upon him and what he's accomplished, you are declared right by the Lord with himself, not on the basis of your doings, but based on what Christ has done in his own righteousness being given to you. Friend, again, I just appeal to you. If you have not come to the Lord Jesus Christ, today is the day of salvation. There may not be another. You're not granted another day in this world. The Lord has numbered your days, and you don't know when that number runs up. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Have eternal life. It can be yours this evening by coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent of your sins, trust in the only one who can save you from them, and live for him who is most worthy. So, circling back, why is it called Good Friday? Why is today called Good Friday? Well, that's why. What we just talked about is why. It's because of what the Lord Jesus Christ has done on the cross for sinners that we come together, that we gather together, that we come to remember what he has done for us. And so tonight we consider the agonies of Calvary, but ultimately we're considering what he accomplished in our place, the good fruit that comes through his death on the cross. As Peter says in 1 Peter 1:18, for Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, so that he might bring you to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. And so, friends, it is such a good day. Good Friday is aptly named. It is a holy day. It is a solemn day. It is a day full of worship and marveling at the love of God. It's good because, as Alvina Hall wrote, For nothing good have I whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's lamb. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful for who you are, and we're, Lord, thankful doesn't even do it justice. We rejoice in what you've accomplished for us, because we know if you wouldn't have accomplished what you've done for us, that there would be no hope, that we wouldn't know you as we know you now. We wouldn't love you as we love you now. And Father, I pray even through this time together that we would love you more. You deserve that, that we'd worship you more fully, that we'd be more of the holy people that you've called us to be. Lord, may we not live in, revel in, or play with that which Jesus died to save us from. May we be those that are devoted to you. And Father, I pray, if there are any lost sheep here tonight, Lord, for those who are under conviction of your Spirit, Lord, I pray that they would see the glory of Christ this evening and that they would lay down their life, that they might gain eternal life in you. Father, we're so thankful for the gift that you've given in salvation, and we rejoice in knowing that it is free. Father, we praise you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, at this time, we are going to be partaking of the Lord's table with one another. And then after we partake with one another, we will have an opportunity to sing one final song, hymn with one another before we close. If you would like, if you do not have a cup and you are desiring to partake with us this evening, if you could please raise your hand. Thank you to the men who are going around to pass out the cups. You just to be clear, you don't have to be a member here at Grace Community Bible Church to partake of the Lord's table with us. In fact, we'd invite you to. But I would ask you, if you are an unbeliever, if you have not put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, please abstain from partaking of the cup and the wafer. There is nothing salvific about these elements. We as the church family gather together to remember and reflect through these symbolic elements, looking back upon what Jesus Christ has accomplished for us on the cross. So if you are an unbeliever, please do not partake with us. To do so would only to be to drink judgment upon yourself. And I'll explain what I mean, because the judgment and the discipline in the case of the church is something that we need to be mindful of as well before we partake. Just one more time, is there anyone else who needs a cup that does not have one? All right, thank you again, men, for passing those out. I'm going to begin reading in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 17. Paul says this, "But this in giving this instruction, I don't praise you, because you come together not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that divisions exist among you, and in part I believe it. For there must also be factions among you, so that those who are approved may become evident among you. Therefore, when you meet together in the same place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in your eating, each one takes his own supper first, and one is hungry and another is drunk. For you do not have houses in which to eat and drink, or do you despise the church of God and shame those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? In this I will not praise you." Then continuing in verse 27, "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must test himself, and in so doing, he's to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. But if we have judged ourselves rightly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we're disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world." Bearing those verses in mind, we see the serious nature of partaking of the cup and the wafer with one another as a church family, that we would make sure that we are doing so with a desire to honor and please the Lord. Because the Corinthian church, they were factious, they were divided, they were not united, they were seeking one another's benefit over others. May we not be a church who's seeking our own benefit or any gain from partaking of these elements and trying to detract from the Lord. We're going to have a moment just to have introspection, a time of introspection. There's unconfessed sin that needs to be confessed. This is a time to do that, to test ourselves, to make sure that we are not drinking and partaking of the bread in an unworthy manner. So we'll go ahead and do that before we celebrate and partake together. If at this time you could go ahead and pull back the plastic on top to expose the wafer, I'm going to go ahead and read verses 23 through 24. Then we'll have a word of prayer, and then we'll partake together. Paul writes this, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was being betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we're so thankful as we consider this text, and we're in awe of the fact that your Son, your perfect Son, the only begotten from you, that he would lay down his life, his sinless life, for us, the ungodly, those who are sinners, the undeserving. But Lord, as your Son gave thanks in breaking bread, we give thanks to you this evening. We rejoice in knowing that your Son has come to save sinners like us. And Father, we reflect and we dwell upon the immensity and just what we can taste of it and understand, which is so limited, but we just focus upon and gaze upon the immensity of what took place at Calvary and the sacrifice of your Son. Father, we partake in dwelling and remembering what took place, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. With that, let's go ahead and partake of the wafer with one another. This time, if you go ahead and pull back the next layer to expose the juice, I'm going to go ahead and read the next verse here in verse 25, and then we'll pray and then partake together. Paul writes this, "In the same way he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Let's go ahead and pray again. Lord, we're so thankful for the, as the hymn writer says, the fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and that when sinners like us plunge beneath that flood, that wash away all our guilty stains. Lord, we rejoice that you have made a way for us to be made right with you through the sacrifice of your Son. We rejoice in the establishment of the new covenant. We're so thankful that the veil has been torn and that we can come directly before you because of the finished work of your Son, any time, any moment, even now. We rejoice in you as we remember these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's partake with one another. At this time, I go ahead and invite our praise team up, who will lead us in one more song before we close out our time together in a word of prayer.
Let's rise once more. Our last hymn will be hymn 281, "Jesus Paid It All."
Snow.
Verse 2.
stain. He washed it white as snow.
Verse 3.
For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Father, we rejoice. We're so thankful. We're so glad that your Son has paid it all. That when Jesus cried out on the cross to Tetelestai, that it is finished. It is truly finished. All of our sins, past, present, and future, paid for in full at the cross. In that we rejoice. Father, I pray as we go forth that we would go forth dwelling upon the wonder of the cross. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, I do invite you to come back and join us this Sunday. We'll be having our service outdoors at 10:30 in the morning. There will not be any childcare during the service. We invite everyone to be out together. And with that, you are dismissed. Thank you for coming out this evening.